I don't think they. I don't think the mic's on.
This is a creation. 22 beer bottle caps. Recycling. Really good.
Well, this is a product of Port
Hey. Now, when you came here to fish, you were mostly fishing for tarpon. In fact, the name of our town was Tarpon, Texas. Pretty cool. We changed it to Port Aransas because we were going to be a seaport. Those Corpus Christi people put paid for that. This rubber ball right here on the bottom probably costs 3 cents at the novelty store. And this is what people did when they fought a big tarpon here. They put this thing in their belly so they could fight the fish. We were pretty primitive, but you know, it worked. And people kept coming back. If you came here to fish, you had to stay, so we built hotels and motels. If you're going to stay and to eat, so we built restaurants, you might have a little party left in you after you caught the fish, so we built whiskey joints, so you could go out and have a good time. If maybe you had a few bucks left or you didn't want to fish at all, we had shops. And that's exactly what we do. And we decided way back then that our job here in Port Aransas, Texas, on Mustang Island, east of the Destego, was to take your money.
Walk into the mic better than he's doing.
He's not doing too good, but I'll just pick it up. I thought he was going to tell us that Rob was from FDR.
Thank you for having me with the housekeeping. Now I'd like to introduce our speaker for the night, who is also a very well-known local fellow. He's known way beyond just the confines of the locale, but he'll never admit that. His name is Jim Maloney. Jim is an advisor, an entrepreneur, an inventor, an historian. Believe me, he is all those things.
Not an inventor, an investor.
And at present, he's in the energy business. He's an owner of Energy Gas Corporation, which rents natural gas compressors throughout the Gulf Coast and South Texas area. He's smart enough to get into gas instead of oil, so those of you who got into oil, I'm sorry. Seems to be falling away around us. Previously, Jim served 6 years as executive director of the Coastal Bend Community Foundation. This is a very important part of our local area. The Community Bend Foundation is a group of wonderful, forward-looking folks holding hands together who help finance things like this museum. Before coming to Corpus Christi in 1981, I mean, that's so far back I certainly can't remember anything before. Jim earned a BS from Rensselaer. Y'all heard of Rensselaer, New York, Polytech Institute, and an MA from the University of Texas.
At
Dallas. It was in Corpus Christi that he began his collection of postcards. You know, let me pause. Jim has an incredible collection of historical postcards. Who would have thought it? I mean, you know, you get hung up on different things. People collect all sorts of stuff. This guy here in front makes a lot of mistakes. He also makes it. Jim collects postcards. Okay. Well, we're a museum. We did too. Historical postcards of Port Aransas, of the region. And this guy, whoever he was, we didn't know who he was. He was just a name on eBay. Every time we tried to buy a historic postcard, he outbid us. It didn't matter what we put on the postcard. We began this game of trying to up the bid until we finally put in a postcard. And all we did was cost him more money. So we decided we better meet the guy. Since then, he's been the best co-operator of the museum that we could invent. He has loaned us all of his postcards. We can scan them. We can put them in our collection. We don't want the originals. We just want the image. He has brought some of those incredible views of Port Aransas, Corpus Christi, and surrounding area. He's quite a collector. After we got to know him and began to cooperate with him, things went straight up to our collection. We have an archive of old approaching 19,000 from the museum. Count them if you want. They're on the computer over there at the museum. I'm sure many of you have looked through them. The guy who does that is the one whose eyeball is stuck to the camera in the back. It's Mark Craven. He is our archivist. Jim is a past recipient. He won the Dan Kilgore local history. That's an important word. Dan Kilgore was an early historian in the area, and he put together and then endowed lots of them, all good. If you don't have them, you should. And they're available next week. So tonight, Jim is going to present you with his new book. Those of you who've been here long enough to listen to the radio, Dr. Murphy Gibbons, he is one of the Jim has begun to do it himself on the morning radio show, so you need to listen to that. Jim Malone, please join us.
Storm wiped away the golf course.
topic, next chapters, is a chapter on Eli Merritt, who grew up in South Texas. His father was a doctor, Dr. Eli Merritt. During the Civil War, they were living in Banquette, where the Confederate forces actually were hanging out. The Yankees controlled Port Aransas and Corpus Christi, so the Confederates hung out in Banquette, where Dr. Merriman tended the sick and unfortunately dying. And then Dr. Merriman died in 1867 in the yellow fever epidemic. So Eli was left as a 14-year-old boy with his mother and some other kids, and they moved to Corpus Christi and she opened a boarding house. He grew up, and his first job was in working for one of the newspapers. Then he went to Galveston, became a newspaper man, came back to Corpus Christi. Eventually, he and some partners founded Corpus Christi Color back in 1883. And he stayed with the paper until his retirement. Before he died in 1941, he wrote his memoirs, which were in the Color, in the library. And this is a blatant commercial, but our book, Recollections of Other Days, has his memoirs. That book has memoirs of 14 people who lived from mid-1800s into about 1920 in the area, and left their memories, and we put them into a book because they needed to be done. Murphy wrote a column before we tore it down of our Memorial Coliseum, and those of you that live here or year around know, remember the controversy over whether we should tear it down or whether we should leave it up or whatever. And Murphy wrote this hilarious column on just make a decision. And his final solution for us was, since Corpus Christi couldn't make the solution, he was sure San Antonio had the same kind of issue. There was nobody could make a decision on a major city problem. So he suggested we swap our problem with San Antonio, but them decide ours because they had no skin in the game, and we decide theirs. And anyways, a really good column about the history of the Memorial Coliseum all the way up to just before it got torn down. That ramshackle little building is the first building in Corpus Christi. This picture was drawn in the early 1850s, and it is a picture, part of the picture has Kinney's Fort in it. It stood up on the bluff. If you know where the cathedral is, it's down the block. There's a big, tall, brown building, Southwestern Bell Telephone Company. It stood on that piece of property right at the edge of the arroyo or ditch where the water from Lynchburg Park ran down to downtown. And you can see there's a stockade around it, and there were several buildings and storage buildings and so forth. And that building actually stood until the 1880s. There are actually photographs of it, but Murphy wrote an article on the post also. Rosalie B. Hart Prier. Rosalie Hart came to Corpus Christi, or South Texas, as a age six with her Irish family. They were coming over to become settlers at the old St. Patricio Colony. No, they were going to the Refugio Colony. On the way over, her sister died on the ship. She was buried at sea. They got here. She and her mother, their other kids have already passed away in Ireland. She got there and their father died of cholera on St. Joseph's Island before they even got to the promised land of Refugio. Mother went up and they lived in a lean-to next to the fort for a few months. Eventually her mom remarried. That man was killed in the Texas Revolution. No, he died before the Revolution. She remarried another guy. He was killed in the Revolution. So, Mother and Rosalie went back to New Orleans where she grew up and married a Mr. Prier. In the meantime, her mother, Elizabeth Hart, came back to Corpus Christi and became a merchant with a store downtown on the seafront. Rosalie came back with Prier. They farmed about a mile west of downtown, and she had a bunch of kids, and there are a bunch of Priers in South Texas. Some of them don't have a name anymore, but they a good Irish family. She had about 10 kids. And she also left a memoir. It's not in our recollections book because it was really long, and so someday we may do that. The Adams brothers also came to Corpus Christi. They came with their parents in the early 1850s, answering like Henry Kinney's beautiful ads for the wonderful climate and industry in Corpus Christi, only to get over here and find out it was full of lies. They were farmed out as teenagers to be sheepherders. Back in those days, if you were a sheepherder, you went out and spent your contracted period with the sheep raising. Anyway, they became sheepherders, and you, at the end of your contract period, you got paid some money, and you also got paid, in these guys' case, 50% of the increase in the sheep herd was theirs. So after 3 years, William made it 3 years. He's only, Robert made it 3 years. William only made it a year. Robert lived out there 3 years with the sheep. He said he did not see a house for a year, did not step in one for 2 years. And then when actually William wrote about wherever you were out there when it got dark, you took your saddle blanket off your horse, you used your saddle as a pillow, and you slept right there on the Parrot Prairie. And Robert was a tough old bird. He, at age 8, he was farmed out to a guy shipping freight all over the country. It was oxen. And one day he was told to unhitch the oxen, and he didn't. And the guy who was taking care of him picked him up and threw him on the ground and broke his leg, and they did not bother to sit. And he writes that every so often he'd be hobbling along with crutches and his leg would re-break. And it took 6 months for it to finally heal. But they both lived into their 90s. They were tough. Their sister lived to 104. They, with their sheep start, the 400 sheep that they got after they shepherded for 3 years, they started a sheep ranch out in western Nueces County, which was Alice. They eventually became cattlemen when the sheep industry died, and they both were very successful and raised good families, and their stories are also in Recollections of Old Days. Colt Revolver, that story is in, you can see there's a few commercials in here.
And you can buy them at the shop.
Or some of them you can't because you don't have them all, and I've got them all right here with me. But the Great Tales book is a bunch of 50-some stories about life in South Texas, which was the beginning of the West. All those Western movies that you saw growing up, with cowboys and Indians, Mexican bandits and raiders and bad guys and good guys, that didn't happen in California. That happened in South Texas. This was where the real West began. The West that we got, we saw growing up in the Western movies, was right here in South Texas. The Colt Revolver was the thing that made, it was said that God created all men equal, or whatever, but Colt made them equal. Yeah, God created all men, Colt made them equal. And that is the original Colt five shooter. It came apart in three pieces. You had to take the barrel out to reload it. It was cumbersome, but what it would do is shoot five bullets at the same time. And so for the first time after that pistol came along, we could fight the Comanches on an even basis. Because with the long rifle that they used out there as a weapon, once you shot it, it took at least a full minute to reload it. And you had to be standing up. And with the Colt Revolver, you could shoot five times. Now the reason it was important is in the full minute that it took to reload that pistol, that rifle, the Indians could ride 100 yards and shoot five arrows. So this made the fights equal. And so from the beginning of the Colt Revolver, that really turned the tide against, especially the Comanches. That is our Bascule Bridge. That, we believe, is on opening day. Look at the line of cars. But that was commonplace in the 40s. When a ship got, here's why you didn't want that port, by the way. When the ship got within a mile of that bridge, 2 miles, you had to raise the bridge because it took full 2 miles for the ship to stop. So if that bridge didn't go up, they had to stop the ship. So 2 miles equaled 20 minutes. So every time a ship came into Corpus Christi, that bridge went up. And that happened as many as 40 times a day. Which means the bridge was up almost all day long. And it became the common excuse for husbands who were having a brew at the tavern before they went on, "Honey, the bridge was up." And one of the bridge tenders said, whenever anybody asked me if the bridge was up at such and such a time, I always said, "Yes." But that is the ship channel. Today, the Harbor Bridge goes right over there. This is right below the Harbor Bridge. This area right in here is where the Corpus Christi Museum of Science and History is, and then the Art Museum is a little further towards the bay. It gives you an idea of what the city looked like in 1926. Okay. Did you know we had camels in Texas? In 1852, Jefferson Davis was the Secretary of War, and he was looking for a reliable and inexpensive way to haul freight to the western forts. He had two shiploads of camels shipped into Indianola, and they worked well. They could carry three times the weight that a horse or oxen or bike or mule could. They could go far, much further on less food and less water, but they smelled bad and the cowboys didn't like it. And the soldiers hated them. But they continued to be used for a while, and then during the Civil War, they went west, and they were used out, some of them were used to haul goods to the mining territories. Eventually they were all turned loose, and they were hunted. From what we know, the last camel was shot in the 1870s on the King Ranch. But they were very, very useful animal. This is the Cotton Road. You can see up at the top the railroad during the Civil War ran to a town called Allentown, which is up where Columbus, Texas is. It was on the other side of the river. And they were using the Cotton Road to get cotton to Mexico. The U.S. had successfully blockaded all of the Confederate ports and coastline, including Texas. And so the only thing that you could do to get cotton to the world and get money for it was to get it to Mexico. Because once it crossed the Rio Grande, it could go on Mexican ships. Rio Grande was an international waterway, and the Mexican ships were allowed to use it, and the Confederate cotton became Mexican cotton and got sent to Europe and New England, and the money they brought back brought weapons and supplies for the Confederacy. So you can see that road pretty much runs the same direction as the highway does today, Highway 77 down there. And that was the same route that the Mexican army retreated after the Texas Revolution and so forth. And that's the way, this is the same route that Zachary Taylor went to the valley during the Texas-Mexican War. So lots and lots of cotton went down. They said if you went through the Wild Horse Desert, which is this area, it sometimes looked like it snowed. There was so much cotton laying on the ground and caught on bushes and so forth. But it helped to refuel the economy, and King and Kennedy made a lot of money during the Civil War, selling goods to shippers in this area, because they went right through the King and Kennedy ranches. Now here are some of the ranch houses of the cattle barons. Martin Culver on the top, he was a landless cattleman. Acres, but he was the largest cattleman. It was in the days before barbed wire, and you ran your cattle on open